is also Guru Purnima today. We'll chant. Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwarah, Gurur Sakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha.
Thanks, Sanjit. And we are happy to invite you to the interactive session, interactive workshop on the Living Our Highest Values by Swamini Brahma Prajnanandaji. And Swamini Brahma Prajnanandaji has dedicated her life to the serving the Vedic tradition by sharing the teachings of Advaita Vedanta. A Hindu monk who currently lives in Mumbai, and her teachings range from the depth and breadth of self-mastery to self-discovery. She offers regular Vedanta courses online, the podcast Vedanta, the River of Wisdom, and insightful videos, workshops, and retreats in India and abroad as well. She is the author of a book, You Matter, Insights from Vedanta. She is a direct disciple of Pujya Swami Dayananda Saraswati, having studied Vedanta, Sanskrit, and Vedic teachings at Arsha Vidya Gurukulam in a residential intensive 3-year course in Coimbatore and Rishikesh. She studied part-time with Swamini Brahma Vidyanandaji for about 12 years. Her last leadership role was as the country head of Railway Children, an international organization that positively impacted the lives of 1.5 lakh street children. She was former psychologist. Now I would request Swaminiji to start the workshop. Thanks.
Om Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsachanuramartanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum. My prayers and best wishes on Guru Purnima, a very, very auspicious day, night. And also, a day we celebrate our glorious heritage, the legacy that we have all received. We may not know the details of the legacy, but it's like you're sitting on this huge treasure, and one has built a building on top without having done enough excavation. And if you were to only look at the treasure that you have, it would really blow your mind. So there are many aspects about the Shastra, but the topic of today is living our highest values. And this particular verse from the Bhagavad Gita is what I want to dwell on, but in a very different way. And this is a verse that I hope you will by heart and also live by. Yata pravrittir bhutanam yena sarvamidam tatam svakarmanatam abhyarcha Siddhim Vindati Manavaha. We'll unpack this very important teaching, which highlights our Swakarma, or rather Swadharma. How that, if it is a worship, it is a worship because you understand the laws of nature as Bhagavan. And that worship doesn't make you religious or weak. In fact, it makes you phenomenally successful. So we'll unpack this entire verse in the rest of the session. Before we look into dharma, I want us to dwell a little bit on what obsession with other areas of life look like. So we can go to the next slide. Yes, Sanchit? Now here is where I need a lot of interaction. Okay, so we are going to be looking at 4 or 5 areas, and I want y'all to put in the chat box the answers to my questions, that you have to be really quick. Okay, so let's keep dharma on the side for now. If, and imagine, okay, I'm not saying any of you are money centered or money obsessed. If you were money obsessed, then how will it influence your source of security? So I need people to keep typing in the chat box. If you are money obsessed, how will it affect your self-worth? Obviously, you have no money, you are kangal, then of course, then nobody is going to date you. And also, you will think less of yourself, isn't it? Right? Then people are warming up. That's correct. You would feel your value is only, you know, we have this term called net worth. That net worth, high net worth individuals, have you heard? HNI individuals. So that is linked to my self-worth. If I'm money obsessed, okay, what else? How will my life perspective be? Anybody? Come on, it's evening time. If it was an early morning class, I can understand. Okay, come on quickly. I need responses here. How would your life perspective be if you were obsessed with money?
I think chasing for money again and again. I mean, there's a target and then the next target.
Yes. You'll be target focused. You would be anxious. And people will be looked at only as opportunities to earn money. If this person is not going to contribute to my profit, forget it, right? And then you will look down on poor people. You will also say, I want more and more and more. And how much is more? I don't know what that is. And in terms of all the powers that I have been given, okay, the shaktis that I have, all that is going to be used only so that I can make more money and avoid situations where there might be a loss. Okay, and we will be very judgmental of others with according to their money status. Okay, excellent participation. Let's go to the next one. Suppose I was, which is the next one? Is it work-centered or partner-centered, Sanchit? Next slide, please.
Okay.
Let's go to work. Iske pehle. The one before this?
Maybe it's loading slowly for you because...
I see. Okay, because I can see partner-centered right now.
Oh, I see. It's work-centered.
Oh, it is work-centered. Oh, this is strange. Okay. now I see it. Yes. Okay, so if I... Now, this is... the condition with a lot of people, right? In 20s to 40s. So you are so obsessed that with work and nights and days, you don't know when one begins at the other ends. So where will your security come from? As long as you have work, right? So the ones who were laid off or who had to take a pay cut or whose work life is not going well, what's going to happen to their security? What's going to happen to their life perspective? Anything that is not work is out of the window. The work progress will be the metric. right? There's no other metrics in life. If your health is going down the drain, forget it. Let it go down the drain. And your family life, no. And then we will justify. As long as I'm working, I'm providing for the family, it's fine. And this fear of being laid off, the chances are that I will ignore family. The chances are if I'm work obsessed, I will miss out on simple pleasures of living. I will also live in fear ki are agar kaam chala jayega to kya hoga, etc. And you know, opportunities are coming up every day. So I will, half of the time I will be in LinkedIn and I'm thinking, oh, you know, better work opportunity, better work opportunity. And then maybe, you know, whichever job I'm at, I'm not happy. So I will be a slave to my work. Okay. And all the powers that I have, I'm obviously going to use for these areas. Okay, let's look at the next one, which is being partner-centered, partner-obsessed. Whatever we are talking about, it's not about extraterrestrials, right? We can relate to this, I hope. Huh? Okay, so if you are partner-centered, now here, of course, is a typical male-female, but whatever be the, you know, your orientation. So if you are partner-centered or obsessed, then you will feel secure only in the presence of your partner. And if your partner fights with you, has an argument with you, that's it, over. You have a lousy day. And if the person says something in a fit of anger, then your self-worth is very shaky. As long as that person is with me, I am happy. Because you are my be-all and end-all of life. You know, there are these, what do you call them, in these Archie's shops, they have, you are my world, you complete me, etc. So it's all very nice and romantic. And you may genuinely feel that. But if your life revolves around a partner, then it's only about you and your partner. And, you know, unfortunately, if something were to happen, even if your partner sneezes, you will think that, oh God, like my partner's got COVID or something. And all the time, there will be fear. Because anything that we are obsessed with, fear always comes along. Fear comes along because you are afraid of losing. Whatever you deeply, I won't even call it deeply love, but you are obsessed with. And so therefore, even your exposure to spirituality, okay, whatever you are reading, it will all be in service of how I can improve my relationship with my partner. Because that is all that is the be-all and end-all of my life. Are you able to see this? You know, because at different points in time, we have been obsessed either with a partner or with work or with money. And then is there anything else, Sanchit? Can we do the next slide? And then I'm not sure how many parents are here, but if you are a mother or a father, then your whole life revolves around your child. So if my child is happy, I am happy. If my child is not happy, you know, we say, putra pushtaha, aham pushtaha. Imagine, Shankara writes in the Bhashya. So he understands that this obsession with children has been there for a very, very long time. And then also we say, and which is coming from a very nice, noble intention, that, oh, I went through so much suffering. I don't want my child to go through this suffering. And then you can only relate to other parents. People who are single, you look down on them. Like, what? What are you doing with your life? You don't know the great glory of being a mother or a father. You, and of course, you want to control the child's choices. Because you know best, you are the parent after all. And the, you know, management books, self-help books, all that you're reading. And you'll also come to Bhagavad Gita class and say, I am learning all this so that I can be a better mother. It's a good intention. But that is not the only reason why you would be exposed to Vedanta. You know, and all your powers you have not invested in nurturing other relationships of your life. You're obsessed with being a mother or a father. Okay. And then it is these very parents who then not only are controlling, but who lament, who go into clinical depression because their child spoke very rudely to them, etc., etc. Okay. So now, next slide, please. It's taking time to load.
Yes, Mataji, it is already watching.
Okay. So now, what is the way out? Right? Because all these are very important to us. Money is important. Partner is important. Work definitely is important. Work or whatever, you know, people are pursuing their PhD and so on. All that is very important, career. And children are also important. Then what shall we do? All this is possible, and a wonderful balance is possible, if we go along with what the Vedic tradition tells us, which is that if dharma is the center of your life, then you can have money, you can have pleasure, you can have a great career, you can have a fantastic partner, and you can also have wonderful children. All of this with a fantastic sense of balance. Okay, next. So then, what is it that the Upanishad says about dharma? Dharmo vishvasya jagataha. So that which supports the entire jagataha. So jagataha we consider universe, multiverse. And pratishtha loke dharmishtha praja. So all the celebrities, all the influencers, all the people we really admire is because of one particular quality. Maybe they have earned a lot of money, maybe they're very good looking, maybe they have published many research papers, and you wonder about their productivity. How do they manage it, and how do they manage this level of prolificness, you know? So all those are subsets of dharma, and so we naturally drawn towards people who abide even in one aspect of dharma. Upasarpanti dharmena papam apanudati. So through dharma, we can remove all our papa. Why? Because since everything, all laws, all principles supported by dharma, so therefore, tasma dharmam paramam vadanti, dharmi sarvam pratishtitam. So Mahanarayana Upanishad speaks about the glory of dharma and dharma as being the highest. So then we have to inquire, well, what exactly is dharma? Because if we are talking about living our highest values, then some understanding of dharma is helpful. Next. So here dharma can mean any of this. Dharma is a very deep word, and it can be used in many contexts. So the context that we will largely use in this session today is universal principles and ethics. Okay, so I will elaborate more on that. And the second meaning is, you know, when we talk about doing our swadharma or swakarma, that is our duty in the form of different responsibilities towards another. Now, very important to note that our society is a responsibility-based society. It's not a rights-based society. Okay, and I'm not saying one is better than the other, but the understanding obviously is that if I fulfill, you know, let's say as a professor, if I fulfill my responsibility towards my students, then their right to get high quality education is achieved. So it always is a dynamic balance, and that if we perform our responsibility towards the other's rights are met, and vice versa. Then, of course, the word dharma is used in the context of the nature of things. So we will say the dharma of water is to flow and so on. And the fourth meaning is the different rituals, and it is both Vaidika karma and Laukika karma. So that which obviously gives us punya and papa. So we can very clearly see that dharma is not religion. Dharma is not a list of do's and don'ts. Dharma is not a mandate of Hinduism, you know, religious mandate. But dharma being the support of this entire jagat, there are many aspects to it. Okay, we'll go to the next slide. Next slide, please.
We have changed that now.
Sorry?
We have changed that so many times.
Okay, I'm sorry, it's not showing on mine, that's why. Okay.
I think, Sanchit, when you change the slide, just tell the slide number so that ma'am can also go to that slide number so that this lag can be avoided.
Right, okay. Okay. Now, we just quickly familiarize ourselves with Samanya Dharma, okay? So here these are all things that we are very familiar with. We can go to the slide, the next one, which will be slide number 10. Okay?
Okay.
Yeah, so Ahimsa. Ahimsa is not non-violence. Ahimsa is least injury to self and others. Now, why am I saying it's not non-violence? Because the process of living involves violence. As we are living, we whatever we are exhaling, okay, carbon dioxide, and whatever is doing, we are killing viruses, we are killing bacteria, and so on. Of course, you may cover your mouth with some cloth. Then what shall we say about the phenyl that is being used to clean the floors? So life feeds on life. And if you want to practice ahimsa to the absolute, then you have to kill yourself. Okay, I'm not suggesting that you do, but it's not possible to live without causing himsa. But here is where there is sensitivity, you know, and all these values that I am talking about, which really are reflected in Taittiriya Upanishad, Manusmriti, Ramayana, Mahabharata, Yoga Sutras, and so on and so forth. What we refer to as Samanya Dharma are qualities that are inherent in each of us. Because life involves relating to different things, different people. And in relating to someone, I need some norm of relating. How should I relate? And the beauty is that that norm of relating is known to all of us. Everyone knows that we don't want to be cheated. We don't want to be humiliated. We don't want to be hurt. All of us want to be accepted. All of us want to be loved. All of us want to be appreciated, and so on and so forth. Now, which university did you go to learn this? No university. This is what you came with, because dharma is present in every human heart. It's something you instinctively know. And so, whatever Sanatana Dharma or Hinduism tells us, or any other religion tells us about dharma, is just confirming common sense ethics. Okay, so it's not, that we didn't know about dharma until we heard about Samanya Dharma. You look at a little child, this little girl who's playing with her doll, the doll falls on the ground and she picks up the doll, she wipes the tears of the doll and says, "Don't cry." She may not even have proper language, but she will do that. Why? Because she knows that just like when she falls and she gets hurt and she cries, if the doll falls, the doll will get hurt and will cry. There is empathy there. Or like I met this, I went to this person's house and there was a five-year-old boy. And he said that... when are you going to go? So I said, why? So, no, because my friend is going to come to play with me. So, and the parents are feeling very embarrassed. He said, no, don't tell her like this. I said, no, why don't you get your friend? We, all of us will play. So he was most thrilled that all of us will play, you know, because otherwise, and he's being very honest. Children don't have to be taught to be dishonest, right? He's like, it's not about courtesy or manners. You have just come. Okay, when will you go? Because then I want to play with my friend. Honesty, right? Satyam. So we'll go to the next slides, which have the pictures. Yeah. So that's 10, 11, 12 quickly. What I want to just highlight, which is mentioned in all these texts of ours, okay, in our Shastra, that whether it is Ahimsa or it is Satyam or it is the next one, you know, speaking the truth, you know, avoiding white lies and all that, Asteyam, you know, avoidance of stealing or claiming something as yours, all these values, this dharma, samanya dharma, is present in all our hearts. That's why even a thief or a terrorist will put a gun to your head and say, tell me the truth. Okay. So while he may not practice dharma in one area, but he definitely wants you to tell the truth. So even, you know, it upsets us when somebody steals our ideas. And you know, there was a time when there was no anti-plagiarism software. There was no need for it. But now you have to get your thesis through that anti-plagiarism software, right? Because we may think we are all being very ethical and all, but some good, brilliant ideas from here and there are nice, you know. So that's the tendency to take something that is not mine. Okay, it may not be an obvious stealing of somebody's password or stealing of money, but stealing of ideas and passing it off as my own, well, that's a tendency and therefore we have to avoid it. And you know, the thing about these values is that we have double standards, right? So we are selective in the application, in the understanding of the value. And we do that because the value of the value is not understood by us. Because if the value of the value was understood, yeah, why this shaucham is important to me, or why mastery over karmendriyas is important to me, then things would be different. So shaucham was both internal and external cleanliness. Just, you know, the value for not accumulating hurt and guilt. External cleanliness, of course, we know, and we have been hopefully a part of Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, right? So, you know, cleaning up entire Bharat. External cleanliness, but also internal. And there are so many things written in our Shastra around how we build up hurt and guilt, samskaras, and how it starts to affect us very deeply. And so therefore, just as we have, you know, our bathing and moisturizing and perfuming and all that, with prayers, with psychological resolution, with chanting, with honest, simple communication, there can be a lot of shaucham. Then Indriya Nigraha, how we use our sense organs, organs of action, you know, especially in the context of the use of social media. Are we a slave to social media or are we using it well? Okay, Danam, giving, Daya, compassion, and Shantihi, accommodation. This is considered very basic, okay? This is like Samanya Dharma. And here what we have is like the ocean of dharma. So ocean of dharma, which includes all these different values, and it is something that all of us, some of these values we embody very strongly. All of them are important, but depending on our background, our orientation, our childhood experiences and so on, there will be at least 5 to 10 of these values that are very, very, very important to me. And then, so I'm going to ask you all to do one exercise now. We go to the next one. I don't know if it's showing. Okay. Is it 15 or 16?
So Ocean of Dharma includes principles from A to Z.
Let's go to the next one.
Okay.
We go to 15.
If Dharma is my, at the center of my life.
That's right. Yeah, so we started out looking at obsession with work, obsession with partner, obsession with money and so on, or children. And we have already experienced that if we were centered like that, then we have been through a lot of suffering. But if you are centered on dharma, okay, on the practice and the embodiment of these values, then things will be very different in your life. Because you've decided that dharma can be my guiding force. Dharma will be my guiding framework. Why? Because you have seen the value of dharma. What does that mean? That if I don't follow dharma, then I am unhappy. When others don't follow their dharma, so I didn't get the marks I deserved. Okay? Maybe that other person didn't follow their dharma. Maybe they were a little too strict, or maybe they have a bone to pick with me. I don't know. If that person didn't follow dharma, then it makes me very upset. Correct? And we cannot say in the name of Vedanta, no, don't be upset. You know, it is all mithya. So all, you please keep all that aside. Okay, we're talking about dharma here, which really needs to be the solid foundation of our lives. Because only then we are qualified for moksha. Before that, we are not. Okay. So if my value for something, let's say productivity, is high, then I am an embodiment of that value. If I take it to an extreme, then I will have a problem. Because understand this well, dharma is relative, it is not absolute. And in our shastra, there are enough opposing stories that tell us and or give us a glimpse of how dharma is relative. In Ramayana, Bhagavan Rama's devotion to his father is greatly praised and appreciated. Okay, a lot of us will see, how could he do this, you know, just to honor his father's word? Why did he have to go to the forest? He could have said no. I mean, you know, be like a disobedient child like a lot of us have been. Forget it. No, I don't want to go. But he didn't do that. Okay. So his respect, devotion to the father, who was also the king, is highlighted. Then we also have another incident in Prahlada's life, who was being harassed by his father, Hiranyakashipu. And said, no, you must worship me. Well, whereas Prahlada was the worshipper of Vishnu. And then, of course, in the Narasimha Avatara, he comes and he destroys the father. And of course, there are a lot of other things that happen. So the so-called disobedience to father in one instance and an obedience of the father in another instance. Can I say one size fits all? Never. Dharma is relative. It has to be understood in that way. And so A lot of our kaushalam is really in understanding dharma, how dharma applies in different situations. Because dharma is the basis of our security, that I will abide by dharma to the extent I can. And therefore, my self-worth depends on how I live a righteous life. Because the truth is, dharma makes all of us happy. And then the perennial question, which is that, how do I know what is the right thing to do, what is not the right thing to do? Well, think about it from the standpoint of dharma. Dharayate iti dharmaha. What is it that will promote the happiness, welfare, and growth of all people concerned in a given situation? You may take some time to come up with the decision and consensus, building and collective decision and so on, but it is worth it. Also, the kind of choices that you make, because dharma is your basis. Like, what is the value you are upholding? Because if you don't see the value of the value, then there is a lot of fragmentation. You cannot enjoy anything. When I say fragmentation, what I mean is, I feel like doing something, I actually end up doing quite the opposite. And then I am thinking quite something different. I am not together as a person. So we know that when we have been through a conflict of dharma and we have gone against what needed to be done, we cannot relax. We cannot sit calmly, because that dharma that Bhagwan has blessed us with, it bothers us. Because I'm going against my natural nature, which is natural goodness, natural innate goodness that every human being has. We go to the last slide and then we can stop sharing the screen.
Done, Swaminiji.
Yeah, okay. So here is where I think we can stop the screen, yeah? Here is where we have to really think that living a life of dharma, okay? Somebody can just turn around and say, you know what, all this is all religious stuff. I don't care for it. And I am money-centered or I'm pleasure-centered, and that's all that matters to me. Okay. Now, this intrinsic dharma that lies in everyone's heart is really a manifestation of Bhagavan. We can stop sharing the screen. Is it stopped? Yes, great, fantastic. So this is very important for all of us to note, that from where did this dharma come for all of us? I've already said it's something which is very innate to us, yeah? And the Vedic tradition shares with us that what you are calling laws of nature is actually a manifestation of Bhagavan. What? How did Bhagavan enter this picture? So we are all scientific people, laws of nature, and that's it. Ah, hello. Let's look at the historical perspective. So Descartes, Galileo, okay, that time, we are talking few centuries ago. So there was a separation of the church and the state. And there was a separation between reason and faith. So what went in the name of religion and faith was supposed to be kept outside the matters of science. And therefore, earlier, God was considered a part of the bigger picture. But now, in the name of mechanizing the laws, laws of nature, you know, Newton also, he contributed a great deal to this argument. So God was taken out of the picture. Now we all know any law, okay, you all must be having a lot of laws at your hostel or in the institute. The law has to be implemented. There is some intelligence there. There has to be a lawgiver. And there has to be a law implementer as well. So like the Supreme Court, application of, application of law. It's, we may call it a court of justice, but it's largely application of law. So what we are calling laws of nature, what we are referring to as laws of dharma, this natural tendency we have to want to be kind, want to be loving, want to be hardworking, want to be disciplined, want to be there for another person, want to excel, want to be productive, want to achieve, all these things that are present in all of us, they are there because what we are referring to as dharma, all values, they are a manifestation of Bhagwan. How do I say that? Because our definition of Bhagwan is a very all-encompassing definition from Taittiriya Upanishad. Yato va imani bhutani jayante yena jatani jivanti yat prayantya bhisam vishantiti tad vignaya. That from which all beings have come, that by which all beings are sustained, and that by into which all beings resolve, that is Bhagavan. So not somebody sitting in Timbuktu, okay? We were not on, you know, this Brahma, Shiva, Vishnu, okay? They are all the Pauranic equivalents of this definition from the Upanishad, that from which all beings have come, that by which all beings are sustained. How are they sustained? By different laws. Laws of gravity, laws of physics, I mean, whatever little that we are discovering here and there. Then laws of biology. So the human body is such an exquisite piece of just glory. How do the cells know how much to absorb? All parameters are being maintained, okay, homeostasis. How they figure it out? So, of course, science will have some answers for it, but the intelligence of the cells, you know, which psychoneuroimmunology is now just scratching the surface, that the way you think affects your physiology. It affects your hormones and, but how they, I don't know if the cells of my body know English, you know, or whatever language I think in, but it is what it is, that the intelligence of the cells, the, you know, sodium levels, potassium levels, creatinine, all these different levels are being managed in a lot of balance. The intelligence of this entire creation, the different laws that support a new discovery, an invention of something, a startup company, use of certain economic laws, all that, you know, whatever law you are talking about, all of that is a manifestation of Bhagavan. No, but you know, which scientific book has said, oh, sorry, science will not do that. You know why? Because perception and inference are the means of knowledge for science, and we are very happy with that. But Vedanta, which is the sixth pramana, will tell us things that we cannot figure out by ourselves. And therefore, Shraddha becomes very important. So just like I have Shraddha in my eyes, if I open my eyes and I am focused, I will see. So if I have trust in the words of the Veda, not belief, if I have a little working trust, and I open the Veda, I mean, I listen to the Guru, and I'm able to see what the Guru tells me, then I have Shraddha, and that Shraddha has served me well. So here, what we are referring to as definition of Bhagwan has got to do with the practice of Dharma. Because earlier, Dharma would be, oh, if I don't do the right thing, then I'm going to rot in hell or something. You know, we may have these kind of fears or anxieties. Or you say, you know what, I don't care, I'm a rebel. But now Dharma is no longer about just what I think is right or not. Because what I think is right is according to a universal framework. What I think is right is actually in line with Bhagavan. Mark my words. Dharma is a manifestation of Bhagavan. Okay, so Bhagavan in another form, in the context of the intelligence and the material. And when I practice my Dharma, then I am in harmony with Bhagavan. And that's really what the Bhagavad Gita is referring to, that by doing your Swakarma, by doing your Swadharma, you are in harmony with me, Bhagavan. So, you know, we see this. We've seen this in our lives. We see it in other people's lives as well, that when you do the right thing, you're very happy and very peaceful. There would be people who have not appreciated you. There would be people who would have said, what rubbish, you know, how could you have done all this? And so on and so forth. But you find an enormous strength in doing the right thing. That right thing which is good for everyone. Okay? So now, what I think we will do is let me run you through a guided meditation. Okay? I can't see people. I can see very few people. People's videos are not on, is it? Or what?
You can maybe change your view.
3-4 people I see. Huh? Okay.
You can change your view by clicking on the upper 3 dots.
Okay. Which gallery are not visible to me. It's the upper 3 dots are below for me.
Okay.
Yeah, but everybody doesn't have their videos on, no? Anyway, yeah. Hmm. So now, before we go into a guided meditation, let me just check if you all have any questions on what I have said so far. Okay, any other questions we will take later. But what I have said so far, any questions?
Swaminiji, I have a question.
Okay.
So, what's actually contradictory in my mind is that you said dharma is not absolute, it's relative. But on the other side, we're also saying that it is universal. So yes. I'm not able to connect the dots between the two. How do you decide?
When I say dharma is not absolute, means the only absolute is Brahman, that is you, the limitless. Okay? Everything else is relative. So it's universal, meaning that nobody wants to be hurt or cheated or humiliated. Everybody understands that in all our transactions, whether business or personal, we get it. Okay. So that is what I mean by universal. There is no like American kindness and Indian kindness. Kindness is kindness. It may be exhibited in a particular way. Okay, like here in India, if the person is thirsty or not, when the person walks in, you will offer water. And you know, if you are in one of the European countries, what water and all is not a tropical country. So if you want water, you ask for it. So Indian will say, "Arey, what is this?" You know, they are not showing hospitality, but that's not the case. They will show their kindness in other ways. You know, so that's what I mean when I say it's universal. But when I say absolute, means that which applies at all times, in all situations, in all places. And no value, including ahimsa, which is the greatest value, can be practiced in that way. Why? Because we need a group of kshatriyas to defend the country. Their himsa is permissible. We better have it, you know. So there will always be exceptions to the rule, and that's why I say it is not absolute, it is relative. So then of course people will say, but that means you can do your thing, I can do my thing. No. So what we consider as norms for society, for us to interact with each other, is what has been codified into the thing of ethics and then the laws of every country. That's what some justice, the attempt is to maintain justice, okay, uphold justice. To what extent it gets done, well, it depends on both the judiciary as well as the common citizenship. We can't say, oh, judiciary should take care of everything, when basic citizens not have an idea of dharma. Okay, so understand that bit. It's dynamic. Okay, any other question?
Thank you, Swaminiji.
Swaminiji, yours. There's also said that to understand absolute, you must understand relative first. Can you explain why we need to understand relative and then absolute?
This is more in the context of Vedanta, so we will reserve it for another time. Okay. Now, I just want to wanted to take questions in the context of what I have said so far. Yeah. Okay.
Sure. Thank you.
So okay, someone now, asked a question in the chat.
Oh, okay. I missed that.
So he's asking, yes, what if we are not sure of what is correct? What we think is correct now leads to regret, bad results in the future.
Yeah. See, dharma does not give you guarantees. There are no guarantees in life except death. Okay. So if I say, no, whatever I do, it must work and all, well, given the information you had, you took a decision. And the thing about taking a decision is to have the courage to live with the consequences. A lot of us get paralyzed if we think, oh, if I start thinking about the consequences of my decision, I will not take a decision only. Right? So like, for instance, now should I take the vaccine? Should I not take the vaccine? Some people are still debating it. Yeah? Now, I've of course taken it. Now, the ones who are still debating it will say that, oh, I might get a paralytic stroke 3 years later, etc. The truth is, no one has all the information to make the decision. But given the information we have, and given what the country has decided as a whole, and given immune system, health conditions, all that, you are going with whatever seems to be a better decision. Maybe things may not work. That's okay. Because kaushalam in life is about being able to handle anything that happens. That's what Bhagavad Gita teaches us. That whatever happens, dharma will be my guiding framework, and I will be a nimitta. I will be an instrument. Because I am always in harmony with Bhagavan. When I follow dharma, dharma makes me happy, and I am in harmony with Bhagavan. And so it is my worship to Bhagavan by doing my dharma. So we have to still look at the details of it. But samanya dharma is the practice of all these values and principles, not once, not twice, many, many times in different situations. Because you are inherently good, you know, Krishna tells Arjuna, he uses a word anagha. Anagha means you who is capable of no papa, no, I mean, I'm not using the word sin, but that's the sort of, you who never, who is untainted. So look at that, what that will do for the person's self-worth, you know. So this thing has to be understood well, that it's not about being goody-goody. It's because it's that whatever decision you take, maybe you'll have regret and you can handle it, or you will learn from it and you will move ahead. So what's the big deal about it? Okay, now a lot of you filled up the form, and I was really happy to see your responses, because a lot of y'all spoke about the values that you stand for, or that are very, very inherent to you. Now, what for us to figure out, what is my Swadharma? It's a combination of my Samanya Dharma. That means the values that I stand for. Okay, all the values are important, but there are 5-7 that are very, very important to me. In fact, I define myself by those values. So how I bring that into different situations. And then the different relationships that I have, which are specific. So thankfully or hopefully, only you are the daughter or you are the son to your parents. Maybe they have some adopted child also, or adopted dog, or whatever it is. But it is a vishesha dharma. Only you are, in relation in that way to your parents. And therefore, your responsibilities are quite different compared to anyone else. Okay. But we will come back to this vishesha dharma. Okay, so let's do a quick guided meditation. Okay, I want all of us to sit comfortably. Try to see that your back is straight. And keep your palm on your chest. Keep your palm on your chest. And keep it there. Yeah? For the entire duration of this meditation, we will keep it here. We take a few deep breaths. Slowly inhale. And exhale. Again, someone needs to mute themselves. Huh? I don't know who that one is. Now it's okay. Again, a deep breath. You are allowing the body to do its dharma of breathing. It seems like an involuntary action, but this law of involuntary breathing is a law that is pervaded by Bhagavan. Because Bhagavan makes this happen through the laws. So as we sit here with our body relaxing, we bring to mind the qualities, the values that we have nurtured in ourselves. The values and principles that we might be known for. Let's take any one value that we value, that is a part of dharma for us. And let us bring to mind how I embodied that value. I was fully that value in the context of my contribution to another person. That because of that value of mine, whatever it is, it will be different for different people. Because of that value, that other person who is other than my family, that person was helped. The person may have got a different perspective, may have got some help in terms of resources, or the person may feel appreciated or supported. But some impact that was there in that person's life because of me embodying that value. We see what the person says or does. Maybe the person expressed appreciation or gratitude. Maybe the person did not. But we know that it is because of our practice of dharma in that situation that that person was happier. Maybe the quality of life, because of our innovation, maybe the quality of life improved for that person. And then we try and see, turn the gaze inward and see what that makes us feel. We want to do more of this. We feel at home because basically all of us are loving, supportive, and contributing people. It's possible that because of hurt or bitter experiences, we stop ourselves from contributing. But any kind of contribution that we have made in our lives has made us happier. We don't know about the other person, but surely it has made us happier. And so we bring to mind all those at least 3, 4, 5 qualities that we stand for. And then as that value is there in our heart, it spreads to the different people through our actions. It no longer stays in our heart. It touches other people's lives. It touches other people's emotions. The practice of our dharma touches other people's thoughts, behaviors, and very often it will improve the quality of their life. And so then we try to bring to mind, well, if I have all these qualities, which I'm anyway embodying, then what is the change I want to see in this world? And it's not a change that other people have to do. What is it that I can contribute to? Some response will come. Some of us may have thought about it. Some of us may not have thought about it. But the change you want to contribute to in this world is what will give your life purpose. And depending on the value you have, you will look for something to contribute to. For someone, it might be gender justice, because for that person, the value is equality. For someone else, the value may be for innovation, and therefore the contribution will be one aspect of a consumer's life. For someone else, the value may be conservation, and so the contribution may be related to how waste is conserved or how waste is used and put back into the environment. Different values and different contributions that we can make. So try and visualize this. We're just getting started here in this session, and hopefully a lot more clarity will emerge if it hasn't. After the session, when you think more about the change you want to contribute to, starting with yourself. So just as this dharma is in your heart, dharma lies in everyone else's heart. Sometimes inhibited, sometimes uninhibited. And therefore, we find a lot of people being very naturally dharmika. But anyway, here we appreciate ourselves for having practiced dharma. Because in our practice of dharma, we see that we have been in harmony with Bhagavan. As we have moved situations forward for people and for ourselves, we have contributed to the happiness and welfare and growth of others around us. And so when Bhagavan Krishna tells Arjuna, Nimitta Matram Bhava, may you be an instrument, we can see this, instinctively feel it in our bones, that I can allow myself to be an instrument of dharma. It's not easy, but it is something I choose because dharma makes me happy. We can lower our palms and gently open our eyes. I think this is a very good time to have a breakout room. I mean, breakout rooms, plural. Okay. So before we do that, and while Sanchit and the others do the maths about how many breakout rooms, and we would like three people in a room. Okay. So now what are you going to do? You all are going to go into smaller groups, and maybe there might be some instructions that he will give you. And while you are in the smaller room, there will be three of you. So please share with whoever is in your group, what is the change you want to contribute to in the world? Don't say, I want the world to be free of corruption. No, we don't want these statements, okay? Not what you want to see, what you want to contribute to. And because of the values that you embody, how you see that happening. We are not talking about big change, small change, whatever change, because it's something that's important to you. Maybe you're already doing it. We don't know. But by your sharing, which is an act of generosity, you will be generous, of course, and you will also inspire the others. Maybe the other person would have not thought about such a possibility. You know? Okay, is it clear? So, two questions, and we will give you about 10 minutes so that each person has the opportunity of sharing for at least 3 minutes. Okay. What is the change you want to contribute to in this world? And what are the qualities, maybe skills, talents, abilities that you have which will help you contribute? Okay. So we can start going into the breakout rooms. 10 minutes.
Okay. So we have randomly assigned each one of you to one of those rooms. And when we start the rooms, you will be joining. You will get a notification and automatically you will be taken to one of those rooms. And then you can get, you have 10 minutes or so to discuss amongst yourself and come up with some ideas and answers to that question. I am only worried that maybe Swamiji also we have added to one of those rooms. Is that fine? Or?
Okay, that's fine. I will be a listener.
Okay. So we'll start a room and so start it. You will get a notification in some seconds.
We are three in a group. Can you hear me?
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Yukti here.
My name is Surendra.
All are there in our group? Yes, I can hear you.
What is the first question?
The first question was how, what change you want to see in the world?
You want to start?
I can stop. So the change that I want to see in the world is compassionate people.
Okay.
Pardon?
I want to see more compassionate people in the world.
The change I want, I expect in this world is good governance. Good governance is, you know, good managing of the society, neat, clean, you know, proper implementation of the good governance. This is what I am expecting in the society. This is what the change I need in the society for which I want to contribute.
Okay.
The contribute I used to do is the, from my side is that. No, because we were working, we never used to have time for to work any charity organization. So what I selected was, you know, I used to be in that managing committee of my building. So we used to manage the society, because that's also honorary service. We do a lot of contribute to the well-being of the society.
Okay, so at least now your society has good governance, right?
Yeah, it's, we are trying. It's not that easy. Not, it's like any other society.
Okay.
It's a cooperative society. Actually, it is a non-cooperative society. The name is always cooperative society.
Okay. So when I received this form for registration, I wrote that I see a lot of greed in people these days, as well as insecurity arising out of that greed. So I just had that thought that people should be a little more reasonable in their expectations from the society, from the people, from the family, and they should reduce their greed so that they don't feel insecure. But in today's discussion, you know, when Swaminiji was asking the question that what contribution you would like to make to the society, I am financially independent myself, and I have a passion for learning and development. So I'm too much into studies, and I'm a financial, like certified public accountant. I've done a lot of certifications. And I see that a lot of students, especially the ones which are not financially, they have limited finance resources. I would like to help them. So I started going to one of the blind school that we have in my locality. It has a hostel where all the blind children, they stay and study. And sometimes they do not have readers because they want to, listen and then do their practice for their exam preparation. So I went there and did reading for them, and I just helped them as much as I can in my own capacity. So this is...
Where are you based?
I am in New Delhi.
A public certified accountant with CA.
No, I am a certified public accountant in USA. I have done that from USA.
CPA,
yes. So that's my area of, I think, expertise as well as my passion, teaching and, helping students to come up on the learning curve.
I'm also a practicing company secretary.
Oh, okay, very good. Chitraji, you are in our group?
Yeah, Chitraji, yes.
Chitraji, you are on mute.
Yeah.
3% in group.
Okay. Okay. Hello, hi. I thought I can contribute some people in the slum areas to help more of them to study, to be financially independent, but I haven't started anything to do about that. I'm just thinking of it.
Okay. So where are you based in? Are you like which part?
I'm in Coimbatore.
Okay. And Surendranji, where are you based?
I'm in Bombay.
Okay.
Namaste, Sabiko. So I'm the organizer, and luckily I got into this room.
That's okay. So you will be only listener, or you would be sharing the answers to the question?
I can also share. I am also trying to participate. And still thinking about what could be the answer. So maybe you guys can continue, and maybe at last I'll say something if I can.
Sure.
Yeah.
I think we already answered two questions that Swamiji asked.
What is second? Both are same.
What was the third one?
No, both were not same. The first one was what change we want to see.
What is your contribution?
And second one was how would you like to contribute to the society?
That is interlinked.
Yeah.
Both are interlinked.
Both are interlinked, yes.
Since I joined late, can you share what kind of answers are there?
So is this Meenakshi?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So I said that I want to see less of greed and expectation management from the people in our society, which reduces their insecurity. And my contribution to the society was that I want to help students, underprivileged students, or the students which are not students which are disabled in their studies and all. And I also started going to a blind school, you know, reading the chapters to them and helping in their studies, as well as a little bit of financial contributions as well. So that was from my side.
Okay.
Yeah, because in our country, I think we still have poverty, and there are a lot of good brains which we do not get the right resources as well as opportunities. So whatever little contribution we can make, that's big for them.
Wonderful.
Have this idea, but they don't know how to start, where to start, how, where to go, when to go.
With our country, because of everybody, it's kind of hard to make their both ends. No, they are not able to make a small community, small group, and move forward to help others. This is not happening.
Right.
I also have some thoughts. So,
okay.
So I'm thinking, like, we see that everyone is searching for something. No one feels fulfilled. No one seems like satisfied. And everyone is running after something. And depending on their maturity, some are running after very like gross things. They want more money and more things. Those people who have already got money, like, realize that it's not everything. So they run after something else. Maybe they want to get famous or some other similar thing. And people who have achieved that also, they're also running. Even CEOs of a company, all are unsatisfied and all that. So, like, there is something which every one of us essentially is seeking. And maybe, like, if that is what I want to see, like, they should get answers what they are seeking for. Something which, like, satisfies them for a longer time, so that this sense of unsatisfaction and all that goes away. And if I can contribute, I will, if possible, I'll try to help people to understand what they are seeking for.
So, Sanjeev, on the first point, do you also feel that, you know, about yourself? So for example, yeah, everyone feels that way. I also, you know, keep searching for something new and not satisfied. And should we first address that situation for us?
Yes.
Because then we would be able to address it for others. Right?
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. What is that? If we get, we will not be searching for more.
Yeah.
That isn't
then all of you should join. All of us should join Swamiji's Vedanta class.
But isn't it seeking our nature? I mean, even if he gets to that point, there would be something else you would be seeking.
Even if we feel sufficient, so he'll never be satisfied.
Yeah. I'm still yet to find very something which is, you know, I really had the urge to contribute, but as of now, what I feel is
that I see a lot of people, you know, criticizing and judging, you know, and they try to be victim of the circumstances. Like whatever happens, you know, they will say because of this, this happened, because of that, this happened. If I have to bring a change, I would like them to come out of this thinking and understand that you know, it is not the external situations which you know, they are dependent on. Rather, I would want them to be very independent. Can't hear you, Chitra. I think you're saying something. Meena, you are also, but I think you both are on mute.
Yeah.
Is it okay?
Yeah, I can hear you.
However, we feel sufficient by some the thing, but others will feel we are insufficient, and then they sometimes we get prompted by their own way of thoughts must be. So unless and until we and unlearn whatever we learn, we will never be sufficient.
So I think I couldn't hear you again.
Just a minute. Swaminiji sent a message that she wants to break these rooms. So I'll click on close rooms and okay. Maybe we'll get some seconds to still discuss.
Sure.
You can continue. Sorry to interrupt.
There any train? Somebody's on the train or what?
Here. Okay, people are back. Some people are back. Others are taking more time to discuss. How was it for you, Girish?
It was good, ma'am.
Okay, this is one group. Okay. Are the others back or is my view?
Plumbly, I was open myself.
Oh, almost 18 people are back. That's good. Excellent. Okay, until the others come. I'm not sure everyone is here. Any reflections on the discussion that you had with your friends, newfound friends? Yes, anyone can share?
Swamiji, I would have loved to have had a conversation, but I was there all by myself.
Oh, right.
So I wrote.
Yeah,
notes.
I think same with me as well, Swamiji. I was also
okay.
There by
so how about this? You know, until the others come, right? Maybe let's just take 2 minutes, and maybe you can share, Renati.
Okay. So basically, thank you for the opportunity. The welfare of others has always been something that I've been very interested in. From childhood, this includes animals as well as human beings. So, it is still a very major part in my life, and I pursue this as my dharmic role. It really is about the well-being, mental and physical well-being of others and animals. How I share these days is quite different. I used to be, you know, I'm the leader, they're the pack. But now, I see myself as being on par. So when I work with people, I am working with myself at the same time. So it has really altered the way that healing has responded in the individuals. And this has been one of the greatest findings of what did this work. And it's a period of over 40 years. The only thing that I find within myself is that sometimes I still dharmically find it very difficult to relate to intense emotions. That is getting better.
To the others' intense emotions or your own?
My own. Sometimes, you know, I do feel quite overwhelmed when people come to me with issues that obviously they haven't been able to get some help, medical help. So I'm giving them through default, I guess, a more spiritual way of healing, including the yogic practices that I do and the pranayama and everything else. So I guess to conclude, as I am aging, I'm finding that I'm becoming a softer person. So I guess that's a good thing. Still achieving, but being much softer about it all.
Lovely.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your work. Wonderful. Yes, someone else wanted to share any reflections, or if you've not had a chance to speak. Only one person in the group. Yeah, anyone?
Swamiji, Meenakshi here. So I was alone, and then for a little while I could join some group. I'm yet to find the few things to contribute, but what I realized is maybe the challenges which I have, I can maybe make that as a way to contribute, since I try myself to overcome those challenges, and a few I could overcome. So, one of them would be I see a lot of people being dependent saying that, whatever happens in their life happens because of the external reason, right? Or maybe the victim approach, to call it into words. So I would maybe like to bring that change in a way that, they're more independent, they're self-sufficient, and they don't, judge others. So this one change I would like to contribute. I'm yet to find more. But yeah. Is it right to say that the challenges which we have, from those we can kind of find what contribution we can make? Because it's so difficult to find that.
Yeah, if in fact, I think it's the other way around, that, when we look around, there's just so much that's waiting to be done. And sometimes it might be that what we choose to contribute to may be a challenge that I have faced, or it may be the challenges that other people are facing, and I happen to have the skills that will help them. That is not only, it's not about me. When you're an instrument, you see that it's not about you. Yes, it makes you happy, and that's fine, but the focus is on them. And also, as Renate was saying, that the way she held power and the dynamism of it totally shifted. Earlier it may have been that, okay, I am there, I will sort you out and everything, and that sort of has become, it has not only transformed her, opened her heart a lot more, and the depth of healing that people around her are experiencing are also tremendous. It's both ways. Actually, honestly, we are more blessed because we can contribute. We think the other is blessed because we can contribute, but we are more blessed because we can. Okay. Anything else anyone else wants to share? Any insights? Was everyone able to figure out what they would like to contribute to and see the connection between the values that you embody and how that percolates and extends into all areas of your life? Are we able to see that? Yeah. Okay, wonderful. So I have two more topics that I want to cover. One, and we will not go into the PowerPoint for this, is this teaching of Pancha Mahayajna. Some of you may be familiar with it. The Vedic tradition teaches us that we have five sets of relationships. Okay? You say, what five? No, I have only one. I'm struggling with one. No, no. You know, because of the emphasis on romance, we think relationship means only romantic. No, we're talking about really relationship. So relationship as in, first set of relationships are to people around you, which may include your family, guests, office colleagues, etc., etc. Then the other set of relationships is with the environment, Bhuta Yajna. So Bhuta Sambandha, the relationship with the Bhutas, and therefore how you choose to relate to them and the sacred responsibility you hold towards them. So some of you are very involved with animal rights, shelter for them, humane treatment and so on. So that's a part of your Bhuta Yajna, that somehow, you know, you are a little more sensitive than others are. And you see the need that, you know, who's, because they cannot protest on Jantar Mantar, you know. So I will help them, okay? Bhuta Yajna, so how we contribute to plants, animals, environment. Then Pitra Yajna. So our relationship with our, starting with our parents and going all the way to our ancestors. So the family traditions that we have inherited, of course, the genes, G-E-N-E-S, we have inherited, and a lot of other things that we have inherited, we are here because of our ancestors. And whatever they did, maybe there is a trauma also, some of that we may have inherited. You know, people who've been through partition and so on and so forth. Lot of stories, lot of rich learnings that are there. So we honor our ancestors. That's a part of our duty. It's not like, oh, it's a nice thing to do. It's a part of duty. And then the fourth is Rishi Yajna. So Rishi Yajna, our relationship, our sambandha with rishis, teachers, gurus, the entire lineage that has blessed us with different kinds of knowledge. Here, of course, we are especially referring to, you know, the Shastra. So, of course, the Vedas and Smriti, Shruti, and so on. And that they generously gave, they didn't copyright, they didn't patent, they didn't sue us because we are chanting the mantras that they discovered, right? So, Rishi Yajna is acknowledging our gratitude to them, and to honor them by living the knowledge, by also sharing what you understand, what you have discovered perhaps, and the Vedika way of living and so on. Okay, the Dharmika way of living basically. And the fifth set of relationships is with our Devatas. So recognizing, you know, because of our modern science thinking, where we have divorced God, Bhagwan from the ways of the workings of the universe, we find it difficult to acknowledge the different deities that are responsible, like heads of department, really, you know. So, but our Upanishads, I mean, our Vedas, they, for each phenomena, there are deities. So Vayu is a deity, you know. So the fact that the air keeps blowing, that's some intelligence there, and that is because of Vayu Devata. So we will say Namaste Vayu Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahmasi. So we address all of them, whatever is happening. So that's why we have no problem. You know, in India, nobody will think you are crazy if you are looking towards Surya. Surya may, it may seem like you're doing it to the Namaskara to the physical sun, but Surya Devata, Savitri, or you are standing in front of Ganga and you are doing Namaskara. Why are you praying to the river? Oh, Baba, she is a Devi. So the Devi is sustaining this natural phenomena. That recognition, okay, that is a part of Maha, Pancha Maha Yajna, that it is our Dharma. So Dharma, don't think I have to do it. No, you don't have to do anything. Okay, there's no shoulds and shouldn'ts. Are you able to acknowledge that the devatas, the deities, the pitras, ancestors, the rishis, the gurus, the bhutas, plants, animals, and people, they are contributing to your life on a daily basis? And therefore, if that much acknowledgement is there, and if we live with that acknowledgement, we cannot help but feel very, very, very grateful. Because you see that every day is a blessing. You don't know which farmer, because of which you are eating the carrots. Okay, and if any of you all have done organic farming or any kind of farming, you know how difficult it is to produce meaning to harvest, let alone do anything else. So many things have to be in the right proportion and at the right time. And right from the milkman to the grocery vendor to the one who comes to clean garbage, so many people are playing such an important role in our lives, just that so that our lives go smoothly. And we can't say, oh, but you know, I paid for it. Yeah, sure, you paid for it. But, you know, money is just an agreement, a collective agreement. We have all said, okay, in exchange of your service, I will give you this. That's it. But it's much more than that, you know. So in acknowledging that all of these play a role in my life, I see that I have a rinam. You know, there is no proper translation in English for it, but we may call it a sacred responsibility. That I have a sacred responsibility to honor and do whatever I can, depending on age and stage of life, for each of these. Okay? So again, like I said, depending on where I am at, the kind of people I'm interacting with, that it is all about reciprocity, dharma. So I have clarity on where I'm headed in life. I have clarity on what is the change I want to contribute to. I see that I am an embodiment of dharma. I see that all the laws of nature are pervaded by Bhagavan. So no longer I have these divisions of inert and conscious and inert. Okay. So Mundaka Upanishad very beautifully says that from a conscious body, okay, human body, it could be animal body also, grow inert things like nails and hair. So if you are going for a haircut, you don't say, I'm going for hair surgery. No. So you may curl it and cut it and shape it and twirl it and whatever else you can do with it. Why? Because it's a part of you, right? And we fuss a lot over it. It's a part of you, but it is inert. That's why we can do all these things with it. And then, so that's, you know, from what is conscious can come something that is inert. The intelligence pervades conscious and inert. And then we have another example that what is, you know, you sow mango seed, eucalyptus, neem, etc., few seeds here and there. And from what is inert, earth, prithivi, life emerges, plants. So of course, yes, they need water, sunlight and all that. But you think, my God, even from concrete, the way this tender shoot just emerges, it's amazing. You would never think, like sometimes in some desert-like places, they just come out from where? You know, with such little resources, they are managing pretty okay. And we complete. So there's so much to learn from just observing things around us. So this is what Mundaka Upanishad reminds us, that you know what? You have divided this, what you see, into conscious and inert. And you think, oh, Bhagavan is conscious. And what is all this inert stuff we are dealing with? Hey, hello, that inert things, seemingly inert laws, are pervaded by Bhagavan all the way. All that is here is Bhagavan. All are manifestations. And therefore, nimitta matram bhava, that may you be an instrument to serve all of these. To serve all of this because it makes you happy. So the first line, yatav pravrittir bhutana, yena sarvam idam tatam, that from which all beings have come, that by which all of this is sustained. First line of that 18.46 verse of the Bhagavad Gita. Svakarmana tam abhyarcha. By you doing your svakarma, you are actually worshipping Bhagavan. But you know, I don't know how to do puja. I don't know a lot of the Sanskrit chants. That's okay. You can learn. If you don't know, no big deal. But by your contribution, you are upholding dharma. And dharma is what upholds society and civilizations. And therefore, you are moving things forward. No one is so small that they cannot contribute anything. And no one is so big that they cannot receive any contribution. So you see that and you contribute whatever you can. That is your worship. So svakarmana tam abhyarcha siddhim vindati manavaha. That person who does this gains success. Siddhi, don't think is floating in air. Okay. Generally, it also means all these different kind. Siddhi basically means accomplishment. Okay. So making a lot of money, and we always think of these supernatural, miraculous things. Oh, this person can read someone's mind, and then that someone else can read your face, and we get so fascinated by all that. All that is great, okay? If you have the siddhi, consider it a blessing. But even if you have the siddhi, what is the greatest siddhi that Bhagavan Krishna is talking about? It is not floating in the air or shooting an arrow. By you doing your svakarma, by you doing karma that is in line with dharma, given the age and stage of life that you are in, you are worshipping Bhagavan and you are also gaining jnana yogyata. You are now ready for moksha. So, you know, one of the qualities that there are many qualities mentioned in Adhikaritvam, uparama, swadharma anushthana meva. Okay, uparama is one of the qualities of Adhikaritva, which is a part of the Shamadhi Shakka Sampatti. So by doing my dharma, I am neutralizing my raga dvesha. I don't feel like doing it. You know, so some of y'all who are living away from home, so mother calls or father calls, and then they are telling you, oh, you know, this our microwave is not working. And you're like, you know, I am so far away. Like, come on, you please call up the customer care. What can I do sitting here? And then they're saying, you know, we went for this. And, you know, we went to the doctor and the doctor said this. And you have just 2 minutes before your next class. And you're saying, okay, then, you know, anything else. And then the person is feeling very rushed because the parents want to talk. We are looking for topics to talk. So now what is your dharma in that situation? Is it to bunk the class? No, it's not that. But to say, no, I will call back and definitely to call back. Correct? Because you are doing your dharma to your parents. And you don't feel like doing sometimes. You know, sometimes parents can repeat the same thing 10 times. Okay? We can also repeat the same thing 10 times. Okay? Especially when we are obsessed about something. But to be able to hold that and or the fact that, okay, I want to get my PhD. So that means what? I have to go through all the hard work and discipline. And I want to tear my hair out. And then, you know, amongst PhD students, there are a lot of jokes that are cracked about the fact that you are sinking and, you know, you are drowning and all that sort of thing. Because when the time comes to submit your thesis, then everything is all over the place. But anyway. The point is that the dynamic balance that is required, that we can all learn to adopt, adapt, and really be competent. That becomes the qualification for Vedanta. You know, because you have dealt with the relative, that in the relative world, whatever mastery was possible, you've had very good relationships, you've made very good money, or decent money for a decent life. You've traveled the world. So there's been a lot of bhoga. Good. You have learned from it. It has given you something. It has given you a sense of fulfillment and achievement. But the one who is in line with dharma is still a karta, doer, is still bothered by punya papa, and wants to know, well, what is the reality of all this? Is this really endless? You know, because I want something that applies in all situations, all places, and all circumstances. And dharma is not that. Dharma prepares you for moksha. But you cannot know. You say, no, I want straight moksha. No, sorry, that's not possible. Because the framework for living is dharma, whether you are a wise person or an otherwise person. Okay. So we have, I think we'll stop with that. We have how much time? We have about 4 minutes. If there are any quick questions, I'll take them. No?
I can ask one question.
Yeah, sure.
So, how to know what is our Swadharma?
Okay. Look at the relationships you have. Performing your dharma towards these people, whoever those 5-7 people, that's a part of your Swadharma. Your Swadharma is a combination of Samanya Dharma, practice of all the values, practice of dharma with plus practice of dharma with respect to these specific individuals, plus your contribution to the change you want to see in the world. A combination of all these three things is your Swadharma. Okay?
Thank you, ma'am.
You have to contextualize it to your situation, but these are the three broad components of your Swadharma. That will also include the Pancha Mahayagya. Okay, your relations with all these five factors. Okay, there's one here. I asked this for a friend whom I didn't know how to respond to. We all have some desires, reasonable or commonplace ones, which we probably have to outgrow naturally as we grow spiritually. But is it right for a parent to very strongly force or threaten with extreme consequences their son or daughter to immediately start following what they know is absolutely required of us for moksha and not fulfill the desire? Without knowing the specifics, it's difficult to answer this question. Because if the parents are insisting on something, in any case, for any parent to strongly force or threaten with extreme consequences doesn't sound dharmic to me at all. Okay? Because extreme consequences means what? It does not sound dharmic. Yeah, so it's not right. Okay, anything else? No? Okay, can I ask the organizers if there's anything else?
Thank you, Swaminiji, for the talk. And regarding the summary, like what this talk, what majorly emphasized is the importance of dharma. It is like dharma should be self-centered, unlike artha and kama. And dharma is of different types. One is majorly samanya dharma, the universal principles and ethics, and swadharma, duties in the forms of responsibilities. And later we have learned about pancha mahayagna, daiva yagna, rishi yagna, pitur yagna, manusha yagna, and bhuta yagna. And I hope the viewers might have understood and got more interest in pursuing this. And if there are no questions, then people who wish to join the VSC can drop the email in the chat box. And now I would call Sanjit to end this session with Shanti Mantra.
Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi.
Thank you.
Thank you. Everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.